and so they are parallel. And in the penguin, the head is like this, and the body is like this, they're perpendicular. The duck puts his wing up like this to fold it. The penguin cannot fold his wings. They are fused like this. So when you see the skeleton of them, again, perpendicular, a parallel here, and perpendicular here, plus an arm they cannot fold. And so that's why they appeal to humans. When you ask people what's their favorite bird, they all say penguin. Who's gonna say a duck? Everybody says penguin. And it's because they have that human look. Their arms are out and they walk upright with their head going forward, just like us. Head forward, perpendicular spine, arms out. So that is the appeal of these guys. Here again, you see a duck uses its feet to paddle. Penguins, does this remind you of a bird in the air? Absolutely the exact same motion of penguins swimming in the water as a bird flying in the air. Feet back, they do not paddle, and wings out like that. So their motion is exactly like flight. So the next time someone says penguins don't fly, you say yes, they do.
Under the water.
In the water. Now we'll watch it one more time. It took me 3 days with a GoPro on the end of a stick to get this thing, man. You got to watch it twice because I went to a lot. So this is my job, is to go and tell people about penguins, about Antarctica, and debunk these myths about penguins. They can't fly. They're not like ducks. They look like us. They're all this kind of, they have long legs. So think about, this is what I do. It's not about the science. It's about telling people about this. And I know we're talking about penguins, but if we weren't, what would you say this is?
Snake.
If I said, what is this? I mean, I know we're talking about penguins. But if I just put this up on the first thing, what would a kid say that is?
Snake's
a snake. They'd say it's a snake. Look at these scales. Mm-hmm. It's a snake. And everybody says that. The reality of it is, it's the forewing of a penguin. Their feathers are extremely small, and they're scale. Like. In the early days, they thought the penguin was the link between reptiles and birds. Everybody knew the reptiles were the...
Yeah.
So, but they thought this was the link because of their scale-like feathers. But obviously that's not true. These feathers are extremely small. You do this with your finger, you put it on a penguin, you will easily count way over 100 feathers. You do this to a chicken, you'll count 6. So a big difference between these birds. These feathers not only have to keep the bird warm, but they have to keep them dry. And there's an example of a feather. Very, very small feathers. Not like a duck, not like flight birds, not even close. And that feather is probably only about as big as the tip of my finger. They're very thick. That heavy part there, oops. That heavy part there, the top part, keeps them waterproof, and then all that fuzz stuff down there gets all tangled in underneath that and keeps them warm. The only place on their body that doesn't have feathers is the brood patch. And the brood patch is just big enough for those 2 eggs. In other words, not the feathers that are warm. It's the body that's warm. This isn't warm. It's keeping my body, keeping the heat in my body. This is not a warm thing. This is the warm thing, my skin. So these eggs have to be in here against the skin with the feathers wrapping around it. So they do not sit on the eggs with feathers between them. The feathers have to be around them. All right, and here are those feathers protecting the bird from water. The water just sheets off it. You can see how it protects them, keeps them dry, and keeps them warm. Again, that picture, here's a magnification of it, what it looks like with all those feathery down parts keeping them dry. The chicks, these are penguin chicks, they keep warm because look at those downy feathers, really thick, but they can't stay dry. So these birds cannot go in the water yet. They have to wait until they molt into their adult plumage to get into the water. This is not a deli, this is a king penguin, same kind of thing. Big, you think he's big and fat, he's got all these feathers, and he might be hungry, but if he goes in the water too soon, this is what happens for him. They simply cannot manage it. And so this bird went in thinking, you can get some food, you got cold, you got wet, mm-hmm. you cannot get dry, you probably died. I left, I couldn't watch it because he just got in the water and he can't get himself back warm. So think of us being wet but not being able to get dry, it's freezing. So these guys have to wait. All right, we're gonna go quickly through the biology. Here they come, you're right, they'll be coming in about 6 weeks. The males will come ashore. They can't carry purses, so they can't carry rocks either. So they have to use their beaks, one rock at a time. They bring and they build this lovely nest here, and they stand in the nest and they display, these are the males, they display to the females walking by, and you boys might take note of this. When the females walk by, they bow to them and they sing to them and they request them to come and join them. So they're very, very, very solicitous of the females, and they build this beautiful nest, trying to get the female to go, I like that one. No. So the females strut by and they pick out the nest that they think they want. Now, this is a perfect penguin nest right here, just the right amount of rocks, high enough so the snowmelt doesn't get them. Any female could not resist this invitation of this nest. This is perfect. But some are different. They have big piles, little piles, messy, tidy, big rocks, little rocks. All of these nests are successful. It doesn't seem to make a difference. They all create got women, laid eggs, and raised chicks, so this kind of nest doesn't seem to be a difference. They're big and tall, or sometimes they're not so big. And this guy really needs to step up his game. He never was able to find a female. But look at that nest. I mean, really, to us it looks like a pile of rocks, but to a female penguin, it ain't happening, buddy. So this guy had trouble finding a female. In fact, he never did. It was just didn't work out for him this year. stand there, and they call out, big display, and all the males are doing it, and the females are coming by. They finally get a female, they create a song that is unique for them, and that's how they find each other in the crowd. They lay two eggs, and
isn't that
they
amazing?
Are now an immediate pair for the season. Everybody thinks they mate for life. No, they don't mate for life, so that's one of the myths that we're debunking. And here are some nests with penguins on. The males do the nesting first. Females go off first. The males have come ashore first, built that nest, stood there, displayed to the female, protected that nest from every other male trying to steal rocks. The female comes, lays her eggs, and leaves. Laying two eggs is a lot more work. I'm just saying, you guys. Laying those eggs is a lot of work as opposed to just building a nest. So the females go first. Here's a bunch of males sitting there waiting for them to return. The distance between the nests, this is something I developed for the students. Why are the penguins this distance apart? It's about a meter from here, from the center of each nest is almost exactly a meter. Why are they that distance? Why aren't they further? Why aren't they closer? What is secret about that distance? So if I were in teaching mode with students, I would ask them to come up with ideas, and then what test would you run to see if that idea was correct? What evidence do you want to do? What observations do you want to make? To test your ideas, well, this is not that one, scratch it off. And by process of elimination, which is how science works, we come down to what the real answer is. Anybody have an idea?
Anyone?
I would say warm.
Warmth? Anybody
warm?
Else? Warmth. An idea? Why are the nests a meter apart?
Or wingspan.
Pardon?
Or wingspan. I can't remember how the term is.
Wingspan?
Wingspan.
Anybody with another idea? It's a full-on activity that you could spend with your kids. It's perfect for seventh graders. But the reason is, these guys are very territorial when they're on their nest. And anything that comes close to them, they will peck at. And that includes their neighbor. So they are the exact, you don't see them looking at each other, but if they did look at each other, they're just out of reach.
Hmm.
Otherwise, they would peck their neighbor. Yeah.
Question.
But then why are they, like that explains why they're far apart, but why are they close together?
Why are they close together? Okay, why would they be close together? Oh.
I don't know the answer.
Okay. Yeah, You will in a second, all right? We'll come to something in a second. So anyway, here we go. They hold the egg on their leg. 35 days later, we get a baby chick. I never get tired of watching this, ever, ever, ever. There's usually two, one hatches the day before the other. Here they go, proud parent, two little buddies. They're just as cute as you can possibly imagine. And the parents have to run back and forth and feed them. This one was a new parent. We could tell she was young because she threw up about a quart of food on this poor little baby and couldn't manage it.
Mm-hmm.
And this food is all wasted. It's pink, so it's krill. So I mark that down. Part of my job is to record what they're feeding. We can't be out in the ocean to see what they have, and we don't kill them and open their stomachs. So the only way we know what they're eating is to wait for them to feed their chicks or to see them drop it, and so I mark down krill. They grow very fast. Here is a bird coming back from the ocean with a belly full of food, and you can always tell them because they're walking like this, and they can carry up to 2 pounds of food in their bellies. So think of 2 pounds of butter, and this poor little bird is only this big, but they've got hungry chicks to feed, so this guy is just full of food here for his chicks coming back from the ocean. And the chicks are hungry. They tap the bird's beak to get food. They grow very fast. You can see the bellies here. It takes 60 pounds of food to raise a chick, each chick. 60 pounds of butter. 60 pounds of butter. That each chick is going to get to raise it to full. So you can see the belly on these guys. You can see the flippers now starts to develop as they get older. They get big quickly. They're just fun to watch. I love watching these guys. I never get tired. These guys are really fat. That's a lot of food in that guy's belly. And now look at his feet grow and his wings growing and he's trying to catch up. And they are so much fun. Now they can't be in the nest anymore. The nest is gone. They're sort of wandering around. And they come back to their parents to get cozy. And then they start to look like teenagers, a little bit awkward. And this guy is ready to molt. So this guy's about as big as they get. He's fat. We're happy to see that. And he's going to start to molt in a second. The nest is gone. They huddle together as a group to stay warm because now both parents for food. They require so much food, it takes two parents out looking for it at the same time. When they're not eating, they're sleeping. Big, fat buddies love to see this. And then they start to move. So here they are turning into their adult feathers, which are going to keep them dry and warm. And if they go in the water too soon, and this one did, you can see he came out pretty fast. And this one's not quite ready, but almost ready to. Okay, challenges for these guys. Snowstorms. It's Antarctica. It's summertime, but it never rains. It always snows. Never above freezing. The penguins, remember, they can stay warm as long as they stay dry. So they'll just sit there and let the snow pile up on them. Here, these are all chicks that have just let the snow pile up on them. And this was about a 3-day storm. Doesn't seem to bother the parents too much. These guys can shake it off. These guys just go to sleep and hunker down. And then when the storm is over, they shake it all off. And hopefully it does not melt because of their body heat or the sun coming out before they can get it off of them. If it doesn't, they are wet and they're dead. But very hard for me to watch that. And I'm only allowed to be an observer. I'm not allowed to. Very hard for me to see if that happened. But I can't go down there with a towel and me drain all these guys off. It's not okay to do that, so I have to watch it if it happens. What we're seeing lately, with a little bit of changes in our climate, is we're seeing the snowstorms being too much, even for the adults. So this is a bird on the nest, and she's standing up, so the snow is about this deep, and she can't get out. She otherwise would have just walked away and the snow is coming down, just get out there. But she's on a chick, and she's not going to leave her chick. She is in a hole. Even if she could make it out, the chick would never make it out. So this is something we have to watch. Here's another example. You can see other adults who didn't have to be on a nest. They're out walking on top. It didn't bother them. But the snow piling up around a bird with a chick or an egg, they will stay on it. She's put her flippers out to keep an air hole open for her to breathe. She cannot get out. She has no way to get out. And her chicken, she will die unless somebody crawls over there with their hands and pulls off the snow. That would be me. So remembering that I'm not allowed to interfere, but sometimes I do. In this case, I do. I can't stand this, so I pull these guys off. Alrighty, we're going to come to answering your question about why aren't they further apart. This is the other challenge, the predator. This is the South Polar Skua. He's like a big seagull. No, seagull is like a big seagull. Very aggressive bird. And they eat human eggs and chicks. And they are very large. Their wingspan is like 5 feet. Big guys. Big, fat guys. And here they will two-time a bird that is not close to its neighbors. And here's an example of a bird that is too far away from its neighbors to get protection from its neighbors. When these two guys come in, one will distract the bird, the other will just jump in and take the egg or the chick. This bird, this is such a stupid bird. It's there every single year, and it's always on this nest, and the next closest penguin is like over here someplace. So that's why they're close together, is so that they can help each other in the penguin attack. So in fact, here we are, this bird is flying over, waiting for him to see who's far enough apart so he can get in there and get the chick or the egg, and these guys will all help protect from the attack of this. Mm-hmm. That's why they're close together. But the fact that they will attack each other is why they're not closer together. So that's how that happens.
Mm-hmm. So that's a very good question.
This is a successful catch. They're pretty much, if they want it, they get it. They're very aggressive. But here's why. They have their own chicks. So, this is the food chain. These are protected birds. Jean has to let them take the egg or the chick because that's nature. I do not interfere with it. I really don't. It's hard to see, but it is what happens. We get to see this. The birds' food is in the water, right? So once they're hungry, they go down. I spend a lot of time just watching them go in. They go in big groups like this. Why would they go in big groups? Why wouldn't they go alone?
Safety in numbers.
Safety in numbers. That's exactly right. So I get to watch this, and I see them going in, and they're diving. They're fun to watch. Try to get a picture of the boat. But anyway, I sometimes do. And then sometimes they're out there and they won't come ashore and they won't go in. And I'm going, what is going on? Why aren't these birds coming back to that nest? Because those chicks are hungry. And they sit out there hour after hour after hour, and then I finally see it. And it's hard to see in this picture. It's a leopard seal. And the leopard seals eat penguins. So as long as the leopard seal is patrolling around here, the penguins will not go in the water.
Mm-hmm.
Here's what
good
one
for
looks
them.
Like.
Oh my god.
Big, they're aggressive, and look at the mouth on that guy.
So ugly.
They want one of those penguins, they just hang under the ice and wait for it. Jump there and wham, get it. So we have to watch that. Obviously, I'm not going in the water wrestling out the penguins. So these guys have to eat the penguins, so we have to watch that predation as well. And that's nature. That is what it is. So when the leopard seals around, we get to see a lot of this. All of a sudden, they're coming out of the water very, very fast. So who says penguins can't fly? I just want to show you some fun pictures. These are penguins with bizarre traits. White feathers all of a sudden showing up on the top of their heads. This one was yellow. Isn't that cool? It's so beautiful. We get albinos occasionally. They grow up and look like this when their feathers are white. I've actually never seen an albino adult. This was a chick. I've never seen an albino adult. I'm not saying that they don't make it. I'm just saying I've never seen one. So I'm not sure these guys manage. You saw this. This is a belly penguin, just crazy brown as well. So we do see some anomalies. This one is all black, no white feathers at all. But its chick, here's its chick was normal. So who knows that? Anyway, we do see color anomalies like that. We also saw one with no feathers one time. This was very hard for me. There's no future for this boy. So I wanted to knit him a sweater, and I was told absolutely not. And I wanted to take him home, and I was told absolutely not. so, obviously this guy's not gonna make it, there's nothing I can do about that, but, so we do see some anomalies in the group, poor old guy. This is where I live, it's a tent, it's a canvas tent with a wood floor. My only power is a solar power here, so I have enough power for my camera, my computer, and our radios, and that's it, so I don't have any other electricity. No coffee pot, no microwave, nothing else, just enough for the cameras, the radios, and our computer, so that's it. No running water, so I can't take a shower, wash my hair, wash my clothes. Right, this is the inside, here's my kitchen. The dining room's right here, my bedroom's right here, the office is right here, this is it, there's nothing else. So we live, this is our heat source, it's propane. We have to sort all the trash. Anybody wanna do this?
Yes.
Oh, come on. It's fun, I love my job.
Yeah.
This is our toilet, now anybody wanna? Number one goes in here, number two goes in here. And when you fill up the can of number one in here, we pour it into here, and when this fills up, we call the helicopters to come get it. We cannot leave any trace of our presence there. So pee, poop, everything has to be contained and taken out, so there's nothing left. Number two goes in here, and it's just a 5-gallon bucket, which when it gets full, we put a lid on it and get another bucket. So that's the bathroom situation. Pretty, but it is what it is. And here's where I sleep, in this tent right here. And sometimes it looks like that, and sometimes it looks like that. There's one good part, no running water, no electricity and stuff, but I do have wireless internet, because my job as the education and public outreach person is to take all of what I've just shown you and get it out to as many classrooms and people as I possibly can. And get people excited about Antarctica, get people excited about science, get people excited about penguins, teach them about these things, and engage them in our work. So, sometimes we have storms too, we dig out the tent, not very much fun, but it is what it is. But this is what's in my driveway, so I get to ride the helicopter all the time, so it's kind of fun. And this is us working, we sit around on rocks all day and look for banded birds, and I check feed, what they're feeding. If I see this is krill. If I see this, it's fish. I mark that. We have birds that are banded and we follow their lives. We catch the chicks. That's me catching the chicks. It's chick rodeo. And we weigh and measure them, see if they're bigger than last year or smaller or fewer or all that sort of stuff. And these are me with our two interns. We have interns every year that come down and play with the chicks with us. And at the end of the year, we catch them. And we put these are chicks all ready to be banded. We weigh them in a bag, not very sophisticated, use a spring scale, put them in a bag, record it in a book, not very sophisticated, just science, isn't it? And we measure their wing with a ruler, this is sophisticated science going on here, and we put a band on them right here. This band has a number on it, and they'll wear this band their whole life, and this is how we follow their lives. So we know where this bird is, where it was last year, this year, came back, didn't come back, had chicks, didn't have chicks, but give them a little pat and off they go. Some other of our science, we know how much they feed their chicks because we corral some of them and they have to walk through this hoop which identifies them and step on this which weighs them. So when they leave, we know how much they weigh, and when they come back full of food, we know how much they weigh and therefore how much they're feeding their chicks. We put trackers on their backs. Here's one here. You can see it here with the bird. You see how big they are. This tells us where they go for their food, how long it takes, how many dives, how deep they dive. Do the females go here? The males go here? Did this bird go here and then go here next time? How far do they have to go? They all go the same place. They don't go the same place. So all of these are kind of questions we get answered with this device here. Currently, our project is to put these on their ankles. They go around their leg right here. You can see us putting it on their ankle right here. And it's on them right now. And it's only recording where they are right now. Because we don't know where they are. No one knows where these guys go in the wintertime. So that's what we're finding out. And here's what it looks like on their legs. We have to find this bird next year. That'll be my first job, is to find these birds. Hopefully they bring it back. We find them, we catch them, we get it off, and it worked. So there's lots of variables with the science here. They're out there somewhere. Maybe they're in cracks. They're maybe in a place like this. We don't really know where they are. And we did a preliminary study on it, and here is some tracks of where they are in the winter. Where they are in the summertime is way down here. This is 1,000 miles. So they go 1,000 miles in the winter. Remember, they can't fly. So they're swimming. They're swimming. They're avoiding bergs. They're walking to get out 1,000 miles. This is where we are now. And then hopefully they'll come back to here when the light gets up. That's a long way for them to make. So that's their little migration thing. Again, new stories. I'm going to not go through this. We do get some abandonment of nests. They just give up and they walk away. It's sad, but here I am. The work can be dirty, but it's always fun. Again, my job is to put this information out to classrooms, and I have about 500 classrooms that follow every year. So I have all these activities for them. I'll show you those in a second. And it's always dirty, but remember, there's no dirt in Antarctica, so it's really not dirt. It's penmanship. So you do roll around in the penmanship sometimes, but I don't really care. I just love my work. And they bite. Yeah, they do bite. I'm provoked, attack here by this little guy. I got a bruise out of that one. Maybe bite sometimes, but it's okay. Okay, so here's my job. So here's what I do. And be thinking about this. So you don't want to work with penguins. So you're going to do history. Or you're going to do language arts. Or you're going to do economics or politics or something like that. We as educators have the skills to teach people where the people who are doing this stuff do not. So we are EPO, Education and Public Outreach. There's lots and lots of jobs. And we need people like you. It's all about engagement. So and I'm going to kind of talk about how I do it in science, but I don't care what subject you're teaching. There's jobs everywhere for you. And it's making all of this accessible to the world. Otherwise, how many people read the Antarctic Science Journal? Anybody here? Polar News? Any of these magazines kind of roll off your tongue like they're on the newsstands? No, they're not. Nobody reads this stuff. The reason nobody reads it is because they don't understand it. That's where I come in. That's my job, is to translate. So without engagement, there's no learning. And we all are teachers. We know this. If you don't engage your students, there is no learning. I don't care what you're doing. If you don't engage them, they're not learning. So the first thing you do as teachers is engage your students. And how you do that, I don't know. Everybody's different. This is like the golden rule. If you don't engage them, they ain't learn nothing. Okay, so three parts to a successful engagement or EPO program: accessibility, getting it out there; accessibility, have it understood; accessibility, reach, persuade people to engage in your story. So as teachers, all you're doing is telling a story. You're telling a story about science. You're telling a story about history. You're just telling a story and getting people to want to be engaged in your story. So books don't do any good if they're sitting on the rack. These are books that have all sorts of stuff, but if you don't get the kids to read it, what good are the books? They're not good at all. Here's what kids are reading. This is the stuff here. This is the stuff in the magazine rack at the grocery store, whatever. So, if you have a book sitting here, it's not going to do any good. You have to have your story here where people are going to buy it. Buy it, not just buy it with money, but buy it emotionally as well. Accessible means they can understand it. So you have to have it in a way, pictures, your words, your activity, whatever your graph, your data, whatever you're doing, it has to be understood by them. So for instance, you guys all know about the Likert reading scales. You know there's readability. Mm-hmm. So you guys, any elementary school, anybody? If you're a second grader, there's a list of words that all second graders should know. If you're a third grader, it'd be all the second grade words plus the third grade words. And so if you are writing a book for third graders, don't use any of the words that aren't in the third grade list. Otherwise, the kids won't know it. And if you want to know the readability of a book, I don't care what book you have, you put it into the computer and it will tell you what grade that piece of work is written at. Am I making myself clear, you got? You know about these things?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it makes it original. So here is one example of a original Antarctic Journal paper. I ran it through the scoring thing, and this is what it came up with. There's all sorts of different ones. Difficult to read, hard to read, 12th grade level of reading. What is Time Magazine written in?
Fifth grade.
Yeah, Time Magazine is written at 7. What's People Magazine written at? About 5. People Magazine is written about the 5th grade level. So the original paper is too hard for people to read. Most people. That paper was rewritten in Science Daily, which is actually a popular publication. And so here's the exact same paper, exact same information, rewritten in Science Daily, and fairly difficult to read, hard to read, still 12th grade level. So Science Daily is not a magazine that most people will read. It was rewritten in the New York Times. What's the New York Times written at, do you think? Standard or average, hard to read, 10th grade level.
Mm-hmm.
So two times this article was rewritten for the public, and each time is still way above what most people read at. Mm-hmm. Now, I couldn't help myself, so I rewrote it.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't help myself. And here's mine. Fairly easy to read, 7th grade. And this is about the same as Time Magazine. So they need people like you. The person at Science Daily is not an educator. The person at the New York Times is not an educator. They need people like you to rewrite this stuff, whether it be economics or history, or I don't even care, whatever topic you want to be on. They need people like you to rewrite it so that people can understand it. And that is what educators do. And that's the skill that you guys have. Okay, so here we go. This is the stuff in 7th to 8th grade. People Magazine, I think, is 5th. But that's why people read it, because they can. So here I turn this thing that nobody can understand into this which people can understand. But that's my job as a science educator. This isn't what you would do in a classroom, so this is my job. Who could read this? Nobody. I had to read it 20 times myself. This paper was written by my PI, and 20. So the formal education that this person reads 20, this is above graduate school level. He is pathetic. Nobody can read this stuff. And I have a challenge reading it. So I turn it into this. And then I take these graphs. What does this mean? This is all icky. And I make it, the thing goes up, it goes down, it stays the same. Make it so that people can understand it. So that's my job. Here's another one that, you know, what? And then go like this, and so you can understand it. Science educators, here are your skills. And this is what you can do outside the classroom. You can be a public relations person, speaker, interviews, press releases for companies, organizations. Someone said they wanted to work for the county. The county has people like this. And you as a teacher have the skills to do this kind of stuff because you can talk and tell people the story in a way that they can understand it. You can also be a science writer, and they need zillions of them, and or a history writer, or whatever you want to be, because they need to take the information and change it into what people can understand. You can also be a curriculum developer, there
mm-hmm.
you go, because we want all of that funny history, doodah stuff, and whatever, politics and math and all that things, written at a level for 4th graders, or 5th graders, or 7th graders. Or whatever it is, but somebody's got to do that, and that could be you. We also need people to create short videos. So interview people in politics, or people that working for government, or whatever, instructional videos. YouTube is full of them, and a lot of them are just junk. So we need people with high skills to make something good for people. And connect the informal and formal science communities. Now again, I'm coming from a science background, but connect the formal and informal, fill in the blank, public sector, government sector, whatever. Fill in the blank here for whatever your interest is. We need people to do that. And education web pages, this is really important. So government organizations, political organizations, companies, all have education pages. They need these things developed from academic, whatever. It doesn't matter. You go to a big corporation like Merck, drug corporations, food corporations, banks, financial institutions, they all need an education page so that people can find out about that company or whatever in a way that they can understand. Okay, critical components and great gauging your minds in. Don't just take out science and put in gauging your young minds in. Fill in the blank. Research, guarantee to have a steady pipeline of then people who will understand that. Don't we need people who can understand finance or understand science or understand history or understand all these things? So for me, it's all about science, but for you, it's going to be maybe or maybe not, it will be something else. And it's all about engaging people to go into those careers. Accessible material, importance, relevant to world topics, all of these things. As a teacher, you have the skills to do this. It's all about engagement. I think I said that a few times. But that's my take-home message. If you don't engage them, you ain't teaching. Okay, we do that. So here's kind of what I do. I help children and the public understand these things here. So this is sort of my mission. I talk to kids, I Skype, I sit with the penguins around me and I do Skype calls where the kids look at the penguins and ask questions and the penguins come up and touch the screen and touch me and they get to see the penguins actually being penguins right there and move my tablet around and they can watch the penguins. So this is part of what I do here, but fill in the blanks for your topic or whatever you want to do. And I have a postcard project. They can get a postcard from Antarctica, but they have to make. So they design a penguin postcard, self-address and stamp it. I've had over 46,000 postcards so far. And then I send them back from Antarctica, penguin stamps on it, and answer their questions if they have them. Mm-hmm. So art, geography, following the path of the postcard as it gets to me in Antarctica, and the path of the postcard as it comes back. Literacy, how to address a postcard. You have no idea how many children have no idea how to address a postcard, and I guess the teachers don't either because I get stuff that's totally inappropriate. I can't see it back. It's like
continent.
So, no, it's terrible. Absolutely terrible. I can't understand it. But it's a lesson in how to address a postcard, putting on a stamp, art, geography, science, so many things engaged here with the students, and then they get a postcard from Antarctica with the postmark. Antarctica postmark. So these kids, I have several classrooms here in Fresno that do this every year, and these kids hold on to these postcards. Oh, well, it's their postcard. They made it, so they're. Here are some examples. I get some really crazy stuff. 46,000 of them so far. Here they are. They make a flag for me. We fly the flag out in front of the penguins. So here's kids. Mm-hmm. Some of the flags that have come, they're all different. I don't have the one from Fresno here, but I get tons of these things. They're really fun. And here's kids with all their postcards, they send the pictures of that. So these kids are engaged. They have done something, they're engaged in something, they bought into this, and they care about where the postcards are going and when they come back. I also, they can adopt a nest, and I take a picture of that nest every single day. And they can see what happens. So here's the chicks here. And this is January 8th. And here we are January 19th. So you can see how the growth is. So every day, and band or no band means male or female. So this, here's the banded bird. So the banded bird comes back, banded bird. And then I tell them, no band. So that's the penguins trading places on the nest. So you can see how fast they grow. And this is what the kids follow. And we have a documentary thing, movies. We got clips. We got all this. Lots and lots of stuff on the website. And here's the education page that I have. It's a partly a model, but I have lots of activities here for the kids to get involved in. Many of them are updated every single day with videos and talks and things from Antarctica. So that is what I do as the education and public outreach person for this science team. There's so much work out there. So you don't like penguins, you don't want to go to Antarctica, don't even like science. There's still lots of work to be done. I have all these different sets of questions about the things. This is the adaptation page, why the pale rabbit, you know, all that sort of stuff. Kids to do their research or inquire about why the birds do what they do. Pictures, of course, and did you know, these kinds of things showing how the science works. How did we know that Adélie penguins can dive 150 meters deep? Did you know that? They can. But how do we know that? We make a statement like this, first things the kids should say is, how do you know that? We should have our kids challenge everything we tell them. How do we know what we know? How do we know that what we're telling them is true? Every politician that stands up there and says something, the kids should go, how do you know that? So we're asking kids for evidence. We're asking kids to ask for evidence. That's a good life skill. Ask for evidence. Anything anybody tells you, well, here, how do we know they can hold their breath 6 minutes? How do they know it takes this much to feed the chicks? A whole bunch of these things. And then I tell them how they know. Where's that? So blah, 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 here it is. And all these field questions for them to answer the questions here. And then you touch the picture and the answer's on the back. There's all this junk, lots of pictures. PowerPoints that are ready-made for the classroom. You might be interested in some of these for your classroom. They range from kindergarten right up through high school based on different topics. So I've really put those together in this chat. And then I go around the country and do a lot of presentations at conferences, churches, groups of kids, old people's homes, anything, museums. I was at a museum in Santa Barbara. Anyway, all this stuff. Anybody who calls me, I do a presentation about penguins, and that's my job. It's a pretty cool job. I've done the STA, AAAS. This is the Marine Educators Association, American Geological Union, European. I went to Europe to do it once, SCARS, Scientific Community, and Antarctic Research. Anyway, all these places where I go to tell people about the science, it's not about me. It has nothing to do with me. It's about getting the word out about science and what's happening. So you are a very valuable part of any. Take out research, put in your own effort there, whatever, political or governmental or business effort. You have the skills and resources and the network to make, fill in that blank, not just science, accessible to all. Tell your story so that the people can understand. And tell the story. It's not your story. It's tell the story. Whatever the story is, whatever you're working for, make sure that you do it. Here are some places where you can get jobs. There are lots of jobs. NASA has a whole army of these people. You, they're teachers. NOAA. Did you know the CIA has an education program? Did you know that? I actually applied for a job there. I was too old. Well, I was the only thing I could do. Otherwise, they would have taken me. Turns out the CIA has an education and public outreach department with people, and they want teachers. They hire teachers. So who knew? Parks, state parks, national parks. The water board here has an EPO people. The Farm Bureau does. Museums. Google, Bing, all these people have EPO people, and they all want teachers. So I'm not saying you should go to the K-12 classroom. I'm hoping I'm not encouraging you not to be in the K-12 classroom. I hope I'm not. That's not the message I'm giving you. I'm just giving you a message that there's a whole other side of education, and I will say having your master's will get you there. You probably will not get one of these jobs without having a master's. Same, so I'm glad you're doing it. But there's plenty of work to do, and if this kind of work sounds interesting to you, I hope that you'll choose to think about it. There's plenty of work to do. Just if it sounds good to you, go do it.
All right.
So now I think that's it for me. I know I talk very, very fast, so I don't want to take up all your time, but if you have any questions about this kind of job, this kind of profession outside the classroom, or any other kind of EPO work, or penguins or Antarctica.